thank the, I'd like to thank the Vienna Data Science Group for inviting me here. The topic I'm going to talk about today is researching China's online politics, a data science toolbox, but since most tools have already been introduced, I'm going to talk more about the research and the idea behind it. And I'd like to start with an intuition, because many of you might ask themselves, you know, why do you use online data from a regime that is known for heavily censoring information that is on the internet? And the first answer would be that what the regime or the Chinese authorities think is sensitive is not necessarily what we think is sensitive, and the other way around. So we might consider information to be sensitive, but they don't consider it sensitive. Also, as you've maybe gathered from the news, the Chinese regime relies a lot on open communication, on using the internet, and if they censor everything, of course they cannot pursue the strategy. A good example for this, and maybe a hard test, is, and that's not really part of the research project, but I would like to introduce it as a hard test nevertheless, that for example, if governments or local governments want to purchase something, they have to file a public tender, you know? So they have to list on a website what they want to build, they have to invite tenders from bidders to establish who offers a service for the best price. And just recently, researchers used these tenders, for example, to establish where labor camps are built. Because if you want to build a labor camp in China, you have to list it on a website and saying you want to build a re-education camp. And this is what it can cost, you know? So you can actually find a lot of information that we think is sensitive on the Chinese internet, because they think, well, an education camp is nothing bad. You can even find newspaper articles on, you know, with, you know, how they clipped sort of the, you know, the scissors and the band, and they opened the education camp in Xinjiang, and said, now we have a great education camp, we're gonna re-educate population in Xinjiang. There is more information also, and I'm going into the project right away. The governments at all levels collect also public feedback on public services to enhance policy performance. So people have the opportunity to go on special websites and special fora and type in things they're not satisfied with. It's mostly again about public services, but as you'll see later, you can learn a lot about complaints about public services. And there is a lot of information. This is just one example of what kind of data you can find there. So you have a complaint, you have a lengthy reply that explains to the complainant what has been done about this, if they sort of took any measures, if they took any actions, or didn't take any actions, and you see some statistics. How long it usually takes to resolve an online petition, how many points, so you get to score the public service provider who does or does not something for you, and how many complaints they already have to deal with. So you find all this information online, which is quite interesting to work with, and if you take the time and read some of these complaints, you'll love it. We have counted the number of online petitions or online complaints, as we also sometimes call them before we started collecting the data, something I will talk about in a second. We found out that actually most cities in China, or most cities in China, have a platform where people can write complaints. And you see here in the legend how many complaints you can find in the cities. So some here they have more than 100,000 that you can collect and read. Or if you have a good algorithm to help you with these things. So this is the city level. If you go down to the county level, which is even smaller, you also have about 80% of all counties have these online complaints. And we think that this is a formidable resource to learn something about the interaction between politicians and citizens in China. Again, you won't find any mentioning about, or you won't find any calls for overthrowing the regime and so on. This is going to be censored. You won't find any you know, people insulting the leaders. This is going to be censored. You learn a lot about what the people demand and how governments government officials react to that. Another data source, and I'm sure there will be many questions later, is social media. So people in China use social media a lot. Weibo, which is sort of the equivalent of Twitter. Twitter is not is forbidden in China. So Weibo, people, you know, when they see a protest, for example, they take pictures and put it online. They write about life issues and so on. So social media in China is also a very rich source of information. Another information, or another source of information where you can learn a lot about online politics and the government, is laws and regulations. So a little bit like with the tenders, whenever something happens, whenever there's a policy change, there needs to be a legal document, and these legal documents are also the strategy accordingly. On the other hand, this also means, can the government maybe steer the demands of the population by signaling to them what is a legitimate demand and what is a non-legitimate demand? Okay, so this is the big contours of the project. We are now in our second year, and the 2 years have mainly been spent collecting data. The data looks like this. So for example, here we have one of the biggest forums that exist in China, which, as you can see, if you calculate it, I don't know if there are any salons in here who know how many complaints we have here, but it's more than 1 million. They are here in a small or short format, but if you click on them, you'll get more information related to the headline, the contents, who is responsible for dealing with it, the reply, and so on. The person who made the complaint, and where, what were the dates. And what you have to do, unfortunately, there is so far, maybe you have a better way of doing that, as far as we know. You still, in order to extract this information and put it in a database and analyze it in a way that distinguishes between these different kinds of content, you actually have to write a scraper that tells, that sort of identifies the part in the HTML script that you want and puts it into a row and column of the database. And we use Scrapy for that, which is an amazing program. Ask about this if you have more questions. It's very scalable, it's very fast, it's very patient, and almost an example. Yeah, so for the website you just saw, which is a simple website, this is basically the script that we feed into Scrapy. This is a short one, a brief one, you see your name, Daniel wrote it. But there are complicated websites where you have to write much longer scripts. But the nice thing about Scrapy or Scrapy is, and again, if you're interested in that, please ask us about it, that it's very versatile. So you can adjust it to all kinds of websites, scenarios. And then I think I should mention this because this question always comes. How do you deal with Chinese texts? And what does Chinese text actually look like? Well, Chinese text sources have an advantage and a disadvantage. The advantage being that you don't have to stem it. You know? You don't have endings and prefixes and so on. You only have characters, so there is, you basically have the words there. The problem really is that not every character is a word. Sometimes three characters can be a word, sometimes two characters can be a word. So that means that text like this is very hard to analyze with most of the algorithms that we have. And exception, of course, are long short-term memory networks, which we've tried out, but they are very slow and cumbersome, and we haven't, I think I can say that, we haven't really been convinced so far of their potency in classifying data that we also work. So what you have to do is insert sort of artificial white spaces in the data, and there are programs that do that. They're based on dictionaries, and they will basically divide the text into words, or if you want, give you the words and give you the word class, so the part of speech tag as well. I'm working a lot with this because with some of the other, yes?
Yeah, sorry, just a short question before I forget it later. How ambiguous is that?
How do you mean how ambiguous?
Well, I mean, if you like, the precision is likely that you have words that have two characters and then another word that is also a word but has four.
Yeah.
You would split it basically on the first two and then get two parts that don't fit. So you would actually have two. And then you continue to search for the other ones, but you already have a fault in the first decision. So
that's a problem. So you're right. This is something that I wanted to mention. This is why I said we tried the artificial neural networks for that. We didn't want to use segmentation because, for example, if you have new words or new character combinations, and then not only dictionary, it will not be able to identify it. Sometimes it's wrongly labeled. And according to tests made with pre-labeled data, the accuracy is not even 90%. And that's a big problem because in this way you actually sort of introduce error before you even start labeling. Of course, there are ways to try and deal with that, to maybe identify terms that are not identified by the dictionary by going through the whole process with another algorithm that maybe puts words back together again, but it's very time intensive. So you just have to basically live with this error rate that you have there. Yeah.
So also similar question, was some kind of context used in those neural networks or in this original parsing algorithm that you use? Does it matter in what sentence a word appears?
How do you mean?
I don't know, when it comes to neural network, let's say, did you use some features which describe that this word appears in such a sentence, in such a neighborhood of other characters?
I think we didn't, but I can ask Isabel.
No, we didn't so far, but there are pre-planned word vectors you can download and add, let's say, as a layer to
I see, so basically a word vector would be a solution.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, so we're trying to deal with this problem, but so far for most of the algorithms we're using, we need segmented, but we're not very happy with that. I mean, there is the Stanford Natural Language Processing NLTK, that is performs slightly better, but it's also much slower than this one. And with the volume of data that we're operating, it's just some of the databases have like 150, 160 gigabytes of text, and that takes a long time to do that. Yeah.
We tried spacing.
Spacing.
It's a C-based implementation, highly performant in a free parser.
Yeah.
It's now basically state of the art for 6 or 7
minutes.
But I think spacing doesn't have Chinese.
What is it for Chinese?
Does it have? Yeah, okay. You can.
I'm not sure.
Okay, yeah. I'm not sure either. I've not worked in Chinese. Yeah.
Okay, so basically this is the first step that we're doing. The second step, and as you'll see in this stage, we're just trying to sort of wrap our heads around the data and trying to find out what we have in the data, what there is in the text that we're reading. Because of course you can try and pull random samples, which is something that we're doing, but it's much easier if you sort of have, something like a universe of cases or parameters that you can use to also search the database. And one algorithm that helps us a lot in that is LDA, which most of you will probably know. I've just given you, this is what I've done for a long time now, just trying different LDA implementations, all of which have their advantages and disadvantages. So I'm not going to go into detail here again. This is something that you can ask me later. But basically, LDA, for those who don't know it, is a kind of, and I don't want to make any mistakes, but a kind of a clustering algorithm. So it helps you to identify topics in the corpus. So basically what you do is you say you want 10, 15, 20, 100, 200, 300 topics. You need to specify the parameter, and then algorithm goes through your corpus and sort of puts it into 300, 200, or whatever the number you specified, different baskets. Then in the document indicates how prevalent each of the topics is in each of the documents. And you can do things like this, for example, so you can try, and these are the topics from the complaint database that I showed you in, well, I didn't show you the database, but I showed you the kind of data that I collected. It's, on the one hand, not a very good example because you don't have a lot of correlations here, but what it basically does is you can just check how often different topics correlate in the document. So maybe not a good example for a talk because you don't have correlations, but on the other hand, for a project it's not bad because it means that most of the complaints are very homogeneous, and that makes it easier to classify the complaints. You know, if they're too heterogeneous, you get into the classification problems.
Clarification question is the DLBA just gives you the ability to specify the number of clusters, not the label of each cluster.
No, you
don't. So how did you get these labels?
Okay, no, you specify the number of clusters, and I labeled it according to like the 3, 4, 5 most frequent terms. And as like if all the terms sort of point to one overarching topic, I wrote the name. So if you have, for example, elections, if you have voter, ballot box, candidate, and so on, you know, you can say it's about elections. If you have topics that are ambiguous, I just didn't use them. I mean, there's this test for LBA for the topics that if you sort of change one of the 10 or 7 words that make up a topic and doesn't make sense anymore, you shouldn't use it. So that's actually part of the work, that you need to tweak it in a way that you get topics that make sense. So for example, when I run LBAs, I only use nouns and verbs. I exclude all other classes. I exclude all words that appear more than 50 in more than 50% of the documents. I also exclude infrequent words, and this is how I get to the topic. It performs quite well in that sense. So at least with this kind of data, which is again very homogeneous. Of course, this is. See, yeah, this was the wrong slide now because this is actually not the classification yet, but this is the strength of the individual topic. So this gives you an indication already what people are complaining about or what they petition about. Obviously, Chinese people are very dissatisfied with transport, so they're complaining about low quality buses not going on time, traffic lights not working, and so on. But also education. And education is an interesting topic because it's, of course, very important for parents that their children succeed in school, like everywhere else. And it's also something that, at least at the university level, at the high school level, costs money. You know? So this is something that can actually potentially lead to also a situation that is not only about public services, but becomes a political situation. The same with real estate. Your owner developer, it's conflicts between people who are building houses and people who are buying houses. If these people don't feel that their interests are secure in the current regime, you know, they might that might foment sort of a source of dissatisfaction that might at some point lead them to tilt towards those who want to change the regime.
Yeah. How time varying are these categories? And I'm sort of surprised investors keep it so low. And I would expect that based on the year, based on the property bubble, these things would change.
They change, yeah. I haven't, because I'm already running out of time, but I can show you some graphs later. But what I usually do is when I work with LDA, I sort of have a standard sort of function that throws out this bar plot, the correlation plot, and then for each topic of time, sort of timeline. You know, so you can look at the graphs and you see that it's very time. Okay, so Yeah, this is that. Just also in terms of what we have here, the problem I sometimes find in these categories are that they're very abstract. I mean, they help you to know, of course, to classify them, but it becomes really interesting when you actually look into the complex. And there are some examples of what you can find it there, also to show you that it's not only about I can't find a parking space here, or this is wrong and this is wrong, but that people actually went steam. You know? So here, for example, one person writes and complains about corruption. I made the first sentence bold, the party committee members above the village and below the township level, because this is the reason, according to our experience, why this complaint actually stayed on the website and wasn't censored, because they are complaining about low-level officials. If they complain about higher-level officials, county level, city level, and so on, this would have been immediate. Now, so maybe it was strategic, maybe it was not strategic. But these things where people are really angry and are trying to vent their anger through these platforms, we have these examples. We also have examples of people complaining that because of the birth control policy, they're not finding a wife. So they want the government to help them find a wife, for example. So we have sort of very interesting stuff here. Also something that you can do without a lot of sophisticated machine learning is a good example here in winter, for in winter last year, this year, 2017-18, you know, because the Chinese government wanted to improve the air quality, they phased out coal ovens and introduced natural gas, but there was not enough natural gas. And when this happened, we could sort of track in real time the website complaints about people being cold and the heating not working. So for all kinds of complaints, you can see in real time where people are not satisfied with the situation, and you can use that to analyze a certain case in detail. So I'd say that one value of the database is not mainly to use it for machine learning, but to use it, or to use machine learning and to use clustering algorithms and so on to identify cases that are interesting for sort of a case-by-case inspection. You know, so for example, if you find something where certain parameters that you're interested in are present, you can go and look the case up, find more material, or even go there. This is also something that we do. So we're also traveling to China and conducting field research there, trying to find out if what we find in the data is also present in real life, and also if what people tell us in China can be corroborated by the data we've been collecting. So here you also see an example that in this year heating related complaints were especially serious comparison with earlier years. Just a few more insights that we had. Also, I said it's, you know, you sometimes have in the complaints an option for people to rate if they like the service or if they didn't like the service. So we have about 70,000 to 80,000 complaints where people indicated if they were satisfied with the solution or not. So you can very easily run a logistic regression based on satisfaction and non-satisfaction to see if there are certain issues that are more likely to render people satisfied and others who do not render people satisfied. And it might not be surprising, but at least it's very clear here that issues like compensation, complaints with rural officials, and also land questions, or things that the government profits from monetarily, that they use to generate revenue, that this is very unlikely to receive sort of a satisfying reply. But on the other hand, if you have issues like trying to move residency, traffic, noise is also a very frequent complaint, something that can be easily changed and affects a lot of people, you find that the government is more likely to try and work towards this issue. Yeah.
Just a quick question, what does the scale mean from minus 3 to 9?
Okay, these are the odds ratios. So so this would be three times as likely as zero.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I think I'll skip that because this is actually work. Maybe I shouldn't skip it because this is probably something that you might be able to help with, which is classifying the data. So data classification has been a very big problem. This is actually taken from protest data that I hand labeled and then trained a support vector machine on, but it's not perfect and it's quite difficult to label it. So you know, if you do it by hand, it takes a lot of time. And I was wondering, maybe we can do that later, if anybody has solutions on how to do this unsupervised. I tried k-means, for example, and that didn't perform very well. What did work was for some of the for a subsample to use the topics in the topic model, and then use that to train a support vector machine. But we haven't found a satisfying solution for that yet. But there is also another problem. This shows you an attempt to classify protests and distinguish them from non-protests. So we have a training sample of about 80,000 protests in China about different issues. And we took this sample and took another 80,000 posts from Weibo, from the social media site, and then trained a support vector machine, and then tested how good the support vector machine is in distinguishing or in separating the protest from non-protest. And as you see, it looks fantastic. It looks very, you know, too good to be true almost. So it performs very well with a random sample that we've taken in separating protest from non-protest. But if you then use the support vector machine on a larger sample of several hundred million posts on social media, it doesn't work that well anymore. So you see, for example, posts like Guangzhou welcomed me with a traffic jam, which is because words in the sentence very often are also present in protests or in posts about protests, so you misclassify. The same wage is very common in labor protests. So here, a wage of 5,000 yuan in Guangzhou, how can you live like this? It's also being classified as a protest, but it's not a protest. Also, this long quote here is being classified as a protest, but it's clearly not a protest. And if you have millions of entries that you're trying to classify, and the algorithm gives you 300,000 potential protests, and you have to go through them to actually identify the 17,000-18,000 that are really protests, it's a lot of work, and we're kind of stuck with that. The problem perhaps being that social media posts on protests usually don't use the word protest. They usually don't mention the word protest. No. So in order to know if it's a protest or not, you have to look at the photo. So this is something that we're working on. Yeah?
Just a quick question. Is it a training set and you test set from the same sample?
Yes.
All of them are Weibo posts.
So, we extracted from this website, there's a person who collected, hand-collected posts about protests. And we extracted all posts from Weibo and then took another 80,000 random Weibo posts. And that was the result that we extracted. Yeah, I have a lot more, but I think you know where the direction is going. I think I should probably stop here. Or you want me to go on?
Yeah, why not?
Sure. Okay, good. Thank you. I don't want to bore you. Because now I think we're getting more into the first results that we have. I mean, most results, and maybe this is something that's also interesting for this occasion, are actually on the issue of protests. So with this data set of about 80,000 instances of protests, we see, for example, that labor protests are most frequent. So this is something that we didn't know before. The background why I'm showing you this is that when I started being interested in data science, I thought, okay, this is going to be like the super weapon that is going to give me a lot of insights that I previously didn't have. But in the first, using sort of, it's not necessary. thank you. using RDA, for example, I got a lot of results that weren't really surprising. So people studying China, when I showed them the results of analyzing complaints, they said, yeah, we knew that before. But here there are some things that we didn't know before. So for example, labor protests are so prevalent among protests in China. Also something that we are studying now intensively, that real estate protests have grown. I'm going to show you a graph of that in a second. They've increased, and this is also politically very interesting, and so on. So, yeah.
Right, just before you go on to the next slide. In this slide, investors lost money is greater than transport, and with the K-means clustering in terms of posts, right? That's what was in the K-means clustering, not protests, but posts.
Yeah.
Transport was off the map,
yeah.
and investors lost money was at the tail.
Yeah.
So how do you explain labor being so high for protest and this not aligning with that earlier data?
Very good question. I explain it with the fact that people choose different avenues for different issues. So if you have a labor problem, you don't use a complaint that form, also because it takes time, but you go in on strike, for example. So if your boss doesn't pay you the wage, you just organize a strike. You can't organize a strike on the internet, but you can organize a strike in your production facilities. So it's often spontaneous. With transport, it's different, you know, because transport is something where you can say, well, here's a problem there, but you can't really demonstrate and say, no, we want better buses. It doesn't lend itself so well to protests, especially not against the background that strictly speaking, protesting is not allowed in China. You're breaking the law. The authorities
they allow labor, but they won't allow protests against government provided
yes,
services.
Yes, exactly. No, they don't allow protests against the government. And sometimes, I'll show you something about this later, they crack down on protests. So if you engage in a protest, you might be lucky in that the government helps you. But you might also be unlucky if the government sends in the police. They film you, and you have problems. You go to prison, or you have a negative criminal record. So it's a gamble, basically. So people who are desperate will go and protest and want a good solution. Others who are less desperate and are maybe sort of interested in improving quality of life and so on, but again, this is something that we're exploring. But this is at least my explanation. One actual contribution that I think we've been able to make is that, as I mentioned in the beginning, the Chinese, or there have been reports of all these protests in China, 500 a day, and one scholar coined the phrase of contentious authoritarianism, saying that people take to the streets and then the government has to react. So, the protests are a feature of everyday life for people to signal their interests, and the government has to bargain with them. And this is, the result that I got when I googled protest in China, and I think this is the image that many people who read these reports had, that this is what a protest looks like. When you go through the posts and you search for estimations of crowd size, you find a very different picture. You see that most the posts mention very small crowd sizes. So this is a histogram that shows you how big the estimated crowds were and how frequent the estimates were applied. So most protests are very small. So instead of what I just showed you, most protests probably look like this. So some people standing there with a banner, somebody looking at that, maybe not very interested in the video. So most protests are actually small. And then the question can it still be called contentious? Because if you protest and nobody looks at you, isn't that a sign for the government that they can continue doing whatever they want to be doing? So it might actually be the opposite. Seasonality of protest, this is also something that you can do very well with the data, because you have dates when the posts are supposed to be posted. You see, for example, labor protests happen around Chinese New Year when the grid changes. And they've remained pretty stable. But we also see here that real estate protests have sort of increased to about 20% if you just a few years. So this gives you a lot to actually do some research on and try to find out what the reasons are for that. Also something that I just mentioned, you can use that and look for information on those who post about a protest, if they report that they've been beaten or arrested. And here we have actually code for physical violence. And you also see, this is also something that we didn't know before, that, well, first of all, violence is not infrequent, so it's actually quite frequent, but about 60%, but that it varies across subject areas. So if, for example, you are dissatisfied with transport or labor, also important, it's more unlikely that you are being cracked down on than if you go to a hospital and complain that your child died of false or counterfeit penicillin. I can go into that later if you want to know more about this. Also, issues that we've seen that left people unsatisfied with complaints are also those that are more likely to be beaten down on by the police, like lands and evictions.
I have a question, because now we are being given a lot of statistics about protests, but
yeah.
Before you said that you had problems with classification, what's a protest, what's not. So how were you able to gather this data with having those classification problems?
Yeah, I was unclear, I'm sorry. So this data that I'm analyzing here is the hand-collected data that I mentioned briefly before. So this is only that.
Okay.
So I've been trying to find additional data from social media, but this has not been successful. So for example, this data set ends in June 2016, because those who compiled the data set were arrested. One of the persons is still in prison. So they obviously weren't able to continue collecting this kind of data. So I tried to use social media to identify protests, but I haven't been able to do this yet.
Thank you.
All right, yeah, other things that you can do really well with this data, and I'm going to wrap up with this, is word embedding. So you can, for example, if you want to do keyword searches, if you want to identify keywords, if you, for example, search the label on platform for protests or not, I use some tools. You can use word embeddings, so basically modeling how sort of close words are when sentences are modeled in hyperspace. Also a tool that you could use to circumvent or to identify people trying to circumvent censorship. So Word2Vec is actually a great tool. If you don't know Word2Vec, it's basically the algorithm that gives you the Google results. You know, even if you mistype, it identifies what you've been looking for. And you can use that, for example, if you want to know what nouns and verbs are being used in instances of unrest, you can model that and, for example, distinguish between words that are more central word acquiescence and some that are more towards resistance, and that actually works quite well. So if you need these terms in order to search your data set or to perform a database search, a keyword search or building a dictionary word to make is actually not useful. So we've been using this.
Question
as well.
Here. The word to vec you are using first the translation to English and then using word to vec, or you are doing directly in Chinese?
No, I'm doing it in Chinese. I just did it for your benefit now. So I use a lot of translations, I could have just used automatic Google Translate to translate. Okay, yeah, and the last tool that we've heard about social networks, this is also something that we've been working on with the biographical data, for example. So I wanted to try and find out what are the paths for local party secretaries to be promoted or not promoted, and what positions are more likely to get you to a leadership position. I'm not going to go into that. So The work has just begun. I think we've raised more questions than we've provided answers. One big task is to classify protests versus non-protests correctly. Another task is with the online replies to the petitions. LDA doesn't really work, and other algorithms don't, or other unsupervised learning algorithms don't also really work, because the answers very often relate to the complaints. So you get very different, very similar clusters to the complaints themselves. And it's really hard to sort of extract if an answer was meaningful or not. So this is also something that we're thinking about now. So now the data heroes are reading a lot of replies now and are thinking about ways of how to classify. But then the real work is still before us, and I don't know how to do this, if this is even possible, but how do you use this very diverse and heterogeneous data coming from different sources to, for example, answer the questions that are raised in the beginning? So how do you model the relationship between complaints, protests, policies, and emotions based on this very different data that you have? You know, in the beginning I thought, well, nothing, you know, can go wrong if you have data that goes down to the day, and if you have hundreds of active observations of every day in the year. But the more I've been working with it, the more skeptical I am that it really can work. Maybe you have an idea about that. So, we'll find this out. Thank you.
Could they be steering the relationship, this relationship between complaints, protest policy, promotions, and emotions? Everything that you've shown assumes that the raw data is not biased in some way. So with the ability of chatbots to actually completely flood a network with post-science, are you concerned about that at all? Do you have any preliminary data? How does this work moving forward, given that relatively easy for a small group of people to bias the raw data?
Yeah, and we've chosen sort of a cheap exit by saying that if it's not censored, they probably want it there, but we're looking at the signals they're giving. You know? So we're trying to see maybe how the interactions evolve over time. If
so they could be reinforcing the signal artificially.
Yes, exactly. And that you could find, that's interesting if you find that. But in a country like China, I think you can say goodbye to the notion that we'll get unbiased data. That's just not possible. I mean, we're looking, we have, for example, we're collaborating with the Weibo Scope project that collects Weibo posts before they're censored, so you can get some insight into censorship. Some of the websites we're looking at, they post complaints before they censor them for various reasons. So we got some indications of what gets censored and what doesn't get censored. Of course, you can try and sort of estimate by talking to people, by looking at their complaints, if they sort of match or resonate with the government policies. But it's tricky, you're right. That's when you research in China, you always deal well, not only in China, I think you have the same problem everywhere. How we identify bots. In China, I should add, the problem is not mainly bots, but it's actually people working in the government who are who are required as part of the work to write on social media. Yeah.
How much of the data is available to others, the data you've collected or the data you've used?
I'm going to release the protest data set once I've cleaned it and made sure that, so we're currently doing, Daniel's currently doing some hand coding to see if, you know, the intercoded lines, how high that is. So this is going to be used for the other data. It's the same thing. So once I know that it's been classified correctly, At the latest, when the project is finished, I will release the data. But if anybody wants to collaborate on that data, there are also ways to do that. I think I can't release all the raw data now, but I can release samples, and that will be possible. So I'd be very happy to cooperate in working on this data.
Yeah. And to Ricard, first of all, a very creative way for gathering the data, I have to say. You also showed these law data, all the other things are somehow reliable and derived from solution so far. But this data about the laws, the amount of laws, did you use it anyhow at the moment, or is this currently not used at all?
Also using that, but there are so many different Germans in Baustellen, I don't know how to say that in English, so in construction sites maybe, that you have to deal with currently that. This is something that I'm looking at and I'm doing right now, but I don't have any results. That's also why I invite collaboration if anybody wants to do something like that, wants to co-publish if you're in science, in academia, one basic question I have about the laws, what I want to try and answer is, because it goes down, basically we're counting the law. So, I think the most fundamental question is, are laws being implemented uniformly across China? So if you take sort of a mean for each year of laws being implemented all across China, how big is the standard deviation if you calculate it for all the counties? I would say that the standard deviation is probably very big, that the counties, or at least the cities, have distinct profiles in what kinds of laws they are passing and implementing. And then the question is why? What are the reasons for that? So this is something that we'd also like to find.
Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah,
I'm
publications of this work. So one side is the actual what you found out, and the other side, what I would be also interested in, would you also publish what your experiences are with your workflow you developed? So gathering the data, storing the data. And you said Chinese breaking up the characters.
If anybody's interested in that, I have the feeling that maybe not many people might want to do that. Because if you want to find work about breaking up characters, there is literature there. So on most of these aspects, you'll find something. But I don't know if you convince me that there is something that I can provide that others haven't provided yet. That we haven't provided.
Thank you.